Hey everyone, I'm Ian Norman from Lonely Spec, and today I want to talk about how I make my basic post-processing adjustments on Milky Way photography using Adobe Lightroom. So this is the process that I use on most of my Milky Way photographs. I think it's a relatively quick workflow, and it usually gives me some good results. We're going to be working with a single exposure in this tutorial, so there won't be any noise reduction, image stacking, or any other advanced techniques. This is just my basic workflow for a single frame. Now, to give you a little bit of background on this image, this photograph was made at the White Sands National Monument in New Mexico. This is one of the most beautiful places I've ever been to. Just hiking around the dunes there is a pretty unbelievable experience. If you ever get the chance to go to the White Sands National Monument, definitely don't pass it up. And if you do go there, consider getting yourself one of the 10 backcountry camping passes that they have. I think it's about $7 for a backcountry camping pass, and it's completely worth it. You get to be one of a few hikers that actually gets to stay overnight in the National Monument area. So the photograph that we're going to be using for our example today was made on a Sony A7 Mark II, and at the time I was reviewing the Voigtländer 15mm f4.5 lens. And this isn't necessarily a lens that I would recommend for astrophotography specifically. It does do a very good job, but it's relatively slow since it only has an F number of f4.5. But the results that I have here are what you should be able to expect from a fairly modest camera setup, like an APS-C DSLR and a kit lens. This tutorial should be a pretty good representation of what you could expect out of a basic camera setup like that. So I already have my photograph pulled up in the Develop module in Adobe Lightroom. And I'm going to go ahead and reset all of my settings just so you can get an idea of what the exposure looked like straight out of the camera. So as you can see, this is a relatively dark exposure, and there's a couple reasons behind that. One of those is that my lens was not very fast at f4.5, and I actually used a relatively low ISO setting of ISO 1600. So the reason that I didn't use a super high ISO setting to bring up the brightness of the image was that I didn't want to blow out any of the highlights around the really bright tent. So it was my goal to try and maintain as much dynamic range in the image, and by limiting my ISO to 1600, I was able to sort of preserve some of the details that would otherwise have been lost in the really, really bright parts of the tent. So this exposure is pretty similar to what you could expect of a kit lens set to f3.5 and maybe a 20-second exposure at ISO 1600 or 3200, it's going to definitely be a little bit on the dark side, so I think this is a good representation of what you could expect from one of those basic kits. So since the exposure is a little bit on the dark side, the first thing that I'm going to want to do is bring up the brightness of the photograph using the exposure slider. And we just want to bring up the brightness to the point where we can see a reasonable level of shadow detail. You can see that I am pushing the brightness of the tent up relatively high, but we'll spend some time to recover those highlights a little bit later. So once we have a relatively neutral looking exposure, we can concentrate on white balance and kind of work our way down the basic adjustments. So one of the best tricks that I've encountered for making white balance adjustments on Milky Way photos is to first bump up your vibrance and saturation to 100%. We're just going to do this temporarily while we adjust our temperature and tint sliders. So this allows us to see little discrepancies in our white balance. If we're set too cool, the entire image will look blue, and if we're set too warm, the entire image will look orange. So the point at which we'll have a relatively neutral white balance is the point where we can see a pretty good mix of blue and orange in the image. And the same thing applies to the tint slider. We want to find the point where we have a good mix of pink and green in the image. Now this obviously looks completely oversaturated, so we can go ahead and reset our vibrance and saturation sliders by double-clicking on their labels. And now we're ready to do the rest of our basic adjustments. This image looks a little bit flat straight out of the camera, so we're going to start by increasing our contrast a little bit. And I want to spend some time to recover a little bit of the highlights in the section of the tent. So I'm going to use the highlight slider and the white slider to just drag down the brightness of the blown out sections of the image. Now I also want to try and retain a little bit of the shadow detail that I'm losing in the corners. This particular lens vignettes a lot, so we're going to compensate for that a little bit by bringing up the shadows and the blacks. So next up is the clarity slider. This is a tool that we should be a little bit careful with. If we turn it up too high, it can increase the levels of noise in the image. And in certain cases, it can create some pretty weird halos around high contrast areas of the image, which is something that we'd want to avoid. So I generally like to keep clarity under about plus 50. Just find a happy medium where it's bringing out enough detail in the Milky Way, but it's not kind of overcooking it. All right, this is looking a lot closer to our final result. Now, the colors of the Milky Way are relatively subdued, so we want to increase the vibrance and saturation just a little bit too. And just like with the clarity slider, these are some adjustments that you don't want to go too overboard with. So I usually like to use the same guideline as the clarity slider and not push it up past about plus 50. So this is looking relatively close to our final result, but I want to give the image kind of like a last little bit of punch, and we're going to do that by using the tone curve. Now there's two different forms of the tone curve, and you can access the one that I like using by clicking on this little icon on the bottom right of the tone curves tool. And we want the version of the tone curve that doesn't have the set of region sliders below the curve. And what this will let us do is directly edit the points of the tone curve by dragging them around. So the first thing I like to do is to pull up the black point of the tone curve just a little bit into the gray, and then we'll pull down the shadows and then give the highlights a little bit of a boost. So like I said in the beginning of this video, this photograph was shot on a relatively slow lens, so noise levels are a little bit higher than if we were using something fast like a 24mm 1.4. So we're going to go ahead and make some basic adjustments to noise just using the built-in noise reduction in Adobe Lightroom. So if we go down to the Details tool, we can see that we have two sets of noise reduction sliders. One of them concentrates on luminance noise and the other on color. And you can see that by default, the color noise reduction is already turned up to 25%. This is something that Lightroom does to most RAW files, and I tend to like to leave it right at the default settings of 25%. So most of the noise left in this image is luminance noise, so we're going to start reducing that with the luminance noise slider. And as a general guideline, I like to stay somewhere in between about 20 and 50. That tends to be kind of a good compromise between noise reduction and not muddying up the details too much. As you can see, that already made a pretty big difference in the image. But we are losing a little bit of detail in the image, so I'm going to try and compensate that by increasing the detail slider just slightly. And finally, we're going to add a little bit more micro contrast back into the image by increasing the noise reduction contrast slider. Alright, so that just about sums up my basic workflow for processing Milky Way photographs. I use this workflow in about 90% of my photographs, and if you're just getting started at Astrophotography, these are the basic adjustments that I suggest you make first. And remember, you can always go back and tweak the sliders as you see fit. Let's take a look at the before and after so we can sort of get an idea of the changes that we made to the photograph. So this gives you a pretty good idea of just how much we can push a RAW file in Adobe Lightroom. And remember that this is just the basic workflow with a single exposure. Check out some of our other YouTube tutorials for advanced techniques like reducing noise with image stacking. And check out all of our tutorials, gear reviews, and inspiration on lonelyspec.com. Once again, my name is Ian Norman. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I'll see you next time.